Welcome back to the IBSP. Here's your host, Foxy New.
Welcome back, Fight fans. Welcome back to another edition of the Q&A with the IBFP, and we're just going to dig right into it. The first question comes from Victor, and he states that Oscar De La Hoya put the 160-pound division on notice, saying that Munguia wants all the big names. Specifically, he pointed out Jermall Charlo. How do you think a fight between Charlo and Munguia would play out? Now, Victor, I think that'd be a very interesting matchup. Jaime Munguia has spent, you know, most of his time at 154. He's a very big 154-pounder. I'm sure he'd be fully hydrated at 160. I think it'd be a very interesting fight. We've seen improvements from Munguia in his last fight against Atoli. And then we also see Jermall Charlo facing his second 154-pounder in Dennis Hogan. So I think, while it'll be a good fight, I think at this point it's close to a 50-50 fight. I don't think Jermall Charlo has ever put on a spectacular performance against any particular opponent that was worthy of note. I mean, if you look at a Brandon Adams, he couldn't even stop the guy at 154. He was coming from 154 to 160, moved up in weight. Now Dennis Hogan is doing the same thing. So Jermall Charlo actually has to start fighting middleweights. And on the other hand, Jaime Munguia has to keep showing continued improvement. Both of these guys are flawed, but I think, you know, this will be a good fight, a close fight, 50-50 fight at this point. But Munguia has the potential to surpass Jermall Charlo because he's improving and he's only 22 years old. Great question. Next one comes from a crackhead. He states, what do you think of a fight between David Benavidez and Canelo Alvarez, and why isn't that fight being talked about? The reason that fight isn't being talked about is that David Benavidez is at 168 pounds. Canelo fights at typically 160, and now he's moving up for Kovalev at 175. 168 is where Canelo won a belt at as well, but Benavidez is also on the PBC side of the street, theoretically speaking, so you can understand how the difficulties that's going to take in getting that fight done, seeing how the PBC is not really wanting to work with any other promotional organization, but I'm sure they would welcome a Canelo Alvarez fight. The reason why that fight typically is not being thought of is because Benavidez is still a very young fighter, hasn't accomplished a whole lot, and isn't currently a world champion. He could be after this pay-per-view fight against, you know, Durrell. But let's keep it going. Round 105 states, IBFP, stay humble and unbiased. Great work. Thank you, brother. He also states, okay, here's my question. Do you think Sean Porter is going to give too much pressure to Spence? Spence reminds me of a pre-Maidana Broner, except better abilities. He has faced some tough competition with Mikey, but has never faced a man that's going to be in this bubble just throwing bombs. How do you think he will fare up against that pressure? I think that Sean Porter and the pressure that he brings is going to be an issue for, Errol Spence Jr., but that pressure alone won't be enough to beat Errol Spence Jr. He has to present pressure, he has to give him different angles, and he has to get in and out of the pocket at different times. He has to show Errol Spence Jr. a lot of different looks throughout the 12 rounds. He has to bring pressure at the right times. He has to box at the right times, and he has to use angles at the right times. He has to make Errol Spence Jr. uncomfortable and push him off of his pivot foot. He has to do a multitude of confusing things for Errol Spence Jr. so he can't time him and figure him out. But great question. Gary Manning states, what are your thoughts on the lineal championship belt? I think the lineal championship belt, for the most part is a good thing. But the only reason I'm not really looking for it as of right now, and it doesn't carry much weight with me, is because you see a guy like Tyson Fury, who never rematched Vladimir Klitschko, who pretty much, pulled out of the rematch twice. He's not fighting elite level competition. And so at that point, I really don't think much of the lineal championship, and I give it no weight. Next question comes from Miguel Mojica. He states, Joey Gonzalez versus Shakur Stevenson. I think that's an interesting matchup, but I just believe Shakur Stevenson is too talented, too skilled, and he should just blow past Gonzalez. The next one comes from Ray Hernandez. He states, who would you like to see Virgil Ortiz fight next? I actually think that Virgil Ortiz should be fast-tracked a little bit. I think he's a very special fighter, the best prospect in boxing, hands down. And I think that Virgil Ortiz is ready for a significant step up in competition. And I think the type of fighter that he could be looking at next would be somewhere along the lines of, let's say, a Sergey Lipinets. I think that'll be a great fight. You know, Sergey Lipinets is a dangerous fighter, very good fighter, moved up from 140, knocked out Lamont Peterson. at 147. So Sergey Lipinets would be a very good test for Virgil Ortiz and shows exactly where he really is. The next question comes from Brandon Rojas. Brandon Rojas states, if Canelo Alvarez beats Kovalev, do you think he will defend that title? Absolutely not. And the reason why is, you know, he'll move back down to 160 because his ultimate goal is to, you know, to unify and become undisputed at 160 pounds. But when he sees an opportunity like this to fight a guy like Sergey Kovalev for a world title on a big stage, you know, these are history-making fights, legacy-defining fights. Canelo Alvarez is not a fighter that fights at 175, so to expect him to sit at 175, defend the belt, and fight multiple opponents, it just doesn't make sense. Great question. The next one comes from Barker Raider, and he states, what are your thoughts on Gary Russell's ghetto trash antics against with Leo Santa Cruz's dad? I'm not a huge Santa Cruz fan, but I believe he's not fighting the best, but you never get family involved. And I agree with you 100%, Barker Raider. I understand that Gary Russell really wants the big fights bad. I understand that he really wants a guy like Leo Santa Cruz, but you know, you don't call the guy's father in it. You don't get family involved. You just call him out. You go at him, you show up to his fights, you make him uncomfortable. Every time they mention his name, they should be mentioning your name in conjunction. You have to put the pressure on him that way. But bringing in the guy's family makes no sense, and it's not classy. Great point. The next question comes from Gary Manning again. He states, does the winner of Regis Prograis versus Josh Taylor become a pound-for-pound fighter? Absolutely. You know, these guys are fighting for belts, unifications, and the winner of the World Boxing Super Series. One of these guys should be at least at the very the 10th or 9th spot in the pound-for-pound rankings, period, because these guys would have earned it. Much respect to the winner of the World Boxing Super Series, whether that's Regis Prograis or Josh Taylor. It's a 50-50 fight. Al B states, what's good, Nuke? In my opinion, Canelo looks just as sucked up and drained, weight drained at 160 as he did at 155. Should Canelo stay at 168 after unifying at 160? Canelo's height and reach will always be an issue, but his frame is built for higher divisions. Your thoughts? Great question, Albie. I appreciate it. I actually don't think he looks drained at 160. I think he looked fully hydrated facing a guy like Danny Jacobs. Danny Jacobs was the one who looked lethargic and slow, and he's the one that's actually moving up in weight. I think Canelo Alvarez looked fantastic. I think sometimes Canelo Alvarez may appear sluggish or stationary because of his knee. But at this point, he's doing low impact aerobics to get his knee conditioned so he can condition his body to perform at the highest level. So I think it makes the most sense for Canelo Alvarez to go undisputed at 160, or at least attempt to do so. Great question. The next one comes from Bam Bam. Do you think Jose Ramirez is ready for Terrence Crawford? And if you do, how much of a chance do you give him to win? I think that's an interesting prospect. And, you know, I would assume that these guys would fight at 147 since that's where Terrence Crawford holds a belt. And, you know, if Jose Ramirez, you know, continues to be successful, he moves up, faces Terrence Bud Crawford as a potentially undisputed fighter from 140. I think that would be a very interesting fight. I think Ramirez would have a chance to get the victory, but ultimately I would favor Terrence Crawford. He's just too skilled. He's a tactician. And I also believe he would stop Jose Ramirez at some point in the fight. I just don't believe that Jose Ramirez has the particular skill set needed to compete at the highest level with Terrence Crawford. Great question. The next one comes from Anthony Alvarado. Do you think when Canelo fights an opponent who can control the distance with the jab that he showboats a little bit too much with his defense rather than getting off his punches? That is what's bothering me about the Kovalev fight. Great question, Anthony. I think Canelo Alvarez did showboat a little bit too much in the first fight with Triple G with that jab. You know, when Triple G was jabbing him and it was causing him issues, Canelo Alvarez defensively, he would have good moments and he would kind of showboat a little bit too much instead of staying focused 100%. But I think in the rematch, Canelo Alvarez showed that he was all business, it was all serious, and he was focused. And you know what? I guess that lent itself to a much lower connect percentage that Gennady Golovkin had on the jab with Canelo Alvarez. I believe it was at 22%, 22 or 23%, which is dramatically reduced from where it was at about 30% in the first fight. So Canelo Alvarez has shown great improvement. The next question comes from the Indigenous Black Jaguar. He states, why all the excuses adding up for Spence not wanting to fight Terrence Crawford? Spence's own words a while ago saying it's a mega fight, but now all of a sudden Crawford don't generate enough revenue. That doesn't make sense to me. And you know what? The indigenous black jaguar, I have to be honest and unbiased, it doesn't make sense to me either. And I think we understand that, you know, Errol Spence Jr. is just simply not looking to fight Terrence Crawford. It's a very dangerous fight. He want to put that fight off for as long as possible, delay it for as long as possible. So don't be surprised if he's looking for Manny Pacquiao. And if Manny Pacquiao's not available, don't be surprised if Errol Spence is looking for a mandatory after this. And then after a mandatory, taking another particular fight, he just simply does not want to face Terrence Crawford anytime soon, and the PBC does not believe he can beat Crawford. That's why they're holding it off. Great question. The next one comes from Hobo01. Oh, and I forgot, do you think Lomachenko can move up to 140 or to 147 and still be undefeated? That's an excellent question. Vasyl Lomachenko has lost to Orlando Salido, but I guess what you mean being undefeated since that loss, he has been undefeated since that loss to Salido. He has looked fantastic. He's an elite level fighter, a special fighter, but I think 140 would present a great challenge to Vasyl Lomachenko. I think 147 is out of the question, but I think 140, he could potentially be upset. But he does have a skill set to compete at 140. Because he's so talented and skilled, he can compete at 140. But to be able to get a win against an aggressive and, you know, a strong fighter like Jose Ramirez would be a huge challenge. Regis Prograe, Josh Taylor, I just couldn't favor Vasyl Lomachenko against any of those guys. And that's honest and unbiased. But once again, this is the Q&A with the IBFP. Please share, like, and you must absolutely subscribe.